everyone. Great having you here. As you well know, we have our wonderful Dr. Rick Hansen here tonight to talk to us about his work. He just let me know that he might take everyone through a experiential process. Is that correct? Maybe. I mean, I don't want to commit him to anything, but it looks like it might happen. So, let me do, first of all, some, housekeeping things. We are videotaping the talk. We're only videotaping the speaker, so we're not videotaping the you guys in the audience. I'm going to call you just Rick, if that's okay. Rick is going to also have some Q&A time. We're not going to videotape the person who's asking the question, but the voice will be, of course, recorded. And we're considering putting some, if not all of it, in terms of clips or YouTubes online. So if you want to ask a question, know that if you don't say your name, probably nobody would recognize you. But be mindful of what you're asking if you don't want to reveal information you don't want to find online. Okay? And if you don't want to be online, so you can't ask a question. This is about it. Yeah. I think, as far as organizational stuff, I think we're there. So, Dr. Rick Hansen is a neuropsychologist, and he's an author of Hardwiring Happiness, the New Brain Science of Contentment, Calm, and Confidence. That has been the trigger and the excuse for me to invite him, and to my great, great thrill, he said yes. And a book that many of you own and have read. Buddha's Brain, The Practical Neuroscience of Happiness, Love, and Wisdom. Wonderful book. The first one, I just know a little bit of it, but I'll tell you about a little bit more in a minute. And Just One Thing, Developing a Buddha Brain, One Simple Practice at a Time. And Mother Nurture, A Mother's Guide to Health in Body, Mind, and Intimate Relationships. He's the founder of Wellspring Institute for Neuroscience and Contemplative Wisdom, and he's an affiliate of the Greater Good Science Center at UC Berkeley. Some of you know about it. It's a wonderful place. He's been an invited speaker at Oxford, Stanford, and Harvard, and taught in meditation centers worldwide. I also would like to add here, for me it's important actually, that you have also been in private practice, working with individual clients or patients for many, many years, and that means he has been in the trenches for a long time and knows the challenges of making things actually happen in people's lives. An authority of self-directed neuroplasticity, Dr. Hansen's work has been featured on BBC, NPR, CBC, Fox Business, Consumer Reports Health, US News and World Report, and O Magazine. And he has several audio programs. I already recommend them. I recommend everything that Rick offers. It's of the highest quality and integrity. And with Sounds True, he edited the Wise Brain Bulletin, and his weekly newsletter, Just One Thing, has about 100,000 people already following him, and also appears on Huffington Post, Psychology Today, and other major websites. So just that reminds me, in the back, there's going to be a yellow pad and pens. And if you want to be on Rick's mailing list, on the desk, not right now, but at the end, just write in a very clear handwriting your email address. And he will, for those who are interested, he's going to have a PowerPoint. So if you want the slides, he will email that to you. And you can also get his newsletter. It's a great newsletter. I get it. This is how I stay in contact with him when he and or I get too busy. Where am I? He's a summa or was a summa cum laude graduate of UCLA. Dr. Hansen has been a trustee of Saybrook University and served on the board of Spirit Rock Meditation Center for 9 years. You have on your card the information, the websites, and of course this card is Hardwiring Happiness. To my slight disappointment, we don't have actually copies of the book to sell yet, but you just get on this magical place called Amazon.com, and you can pre-order. And this is a very great thing because it gets you the book right away. And I think I always recommend people. My theme this week here is that books are the most cheapest, most valuable thing on the market. They cost nothing. $10, $15, $20, can't get, you know, lunch for that in a restaurant. So I think if after Rick gives the talk, you probably will think, aside from yourself, probably another 5, 4, 10 people that you wish were here, pre-order a book for them too. Okay, you know me. I think that's a good idea. Now, I have the good fortune to be friends with Rick and his absolutely amazing wife, Jen, who does also incredible work in the world. She's a fabulous nutritionist and an acupuncturist and simply an amazing woman. So, and I dragged her to the front because I wanted to sit next to her. And also I basically have conversations with Rick as professionals. I also had the good fortune to be invited to an 8-week course that Rick did as he was working on writing his book. So he really worked with people, wanted to see, tested out stuff and so on. And I wanted to do it, but I had no idea. And then when I sat in his classes, it was this really wonderful and remarkable experience. So I just wrote it, I don't want to take too much time. So Rick, in my experience, is a gentle teacher, a brilliant teacher. He's modest. So, you know, it's maybe not evident immediately, but it does get evident pretty quickly. He's a loving teacher and incredibly skillful. And like very, very skillful musicians, when they stand on stage and play, it looks like it's really easy. I could do it too. That's when people reach a really high level of skill. That's my experience of Rick. He is really aware of what's going on. He, I think, perceives the complexity of situations and then handles them in a way that if you don't get it, you wouldn't know that he is doing it. So it's incredibly skillful. And for me, something that those of you trained with me would imagine that's very, very important and meaningful. He is what I thought today when I knew I was going to introduce Rick. I thought, how am I going to speak to it? For me, Rick is what I would call a responsible thinker. He's brilliant, so we know that, but there are people who are brilliant and they're not necessarily responsible thinkers. So what I mean is a responsible thinker, he doesn't just say things or declare real or not real truths. He brilliantly thinks, he has this capacity to methodically and looks to me like over time, think things through, check them against his own ideas, his own experience, other people's experience, a course, and whatever he brings into his equation. And when he offers it to us, when he's gone through whatever he goes through, it comes out in a very humane and I think a deceptively easy form. And deceptively, not deceptively that it's not easy, deceptively that behind it there is great complexity and potency, but the presentation is kind of like, oh, water, oh, okay. So, and I love our periodic breakfast conversations. I always leave feeling kind of like educated and new ideas and new things, and he suggests things to me and gives me sometimes feedback. It's very potent and always gentle, so I can always take it. So it's truly my great pleasure and honor to have Rick here give us his time and his knowledge for the next couple or so hours. Thank you, Rick. Thank you.
Well, you might have imagined that that was excruciating to listen to, but good for me. It was a beautiful gift, and I really appreciate it.
You can put it on YouTube if you like.
That was a great gift.
We will.
All right, that's right. Okay, well, let's get to it. I've got to live up to the billing, right? Ooh, the pressure mounts. So a couple of logistical details. I'll stick around afterward. I'll end really close to 8 o'clock. But if you want to talk afterward or bring up a personal situation that you wouldn't want to be broadcast to the barbarians out there or what have you, just stick around. I'll happily talk with you. The second thing is that if you want, I'll send you the slides. And as you'll see, they're really quite detailed. You're very welcome to use them however you want. Almost everything I do is freely offered. And so all I need is your email address, which I will never share with anybody ever. I'm a fan of autonomy and privacy rights. You know, fences make for good neighbors, right? And so I don't like to receive things I don't want. I don't like sending things I don't want, that people don't want to receive from me. And so if you do give me your email address so I can send you the slides, I won't, you know, share it with anybody. And unless you say just slides, I'll automatically subscribe you to my little newsletter, which is a practice newsletter. The one that just went out was Let Things Change. Is that the Ben-Yale method or not? Okay, all right. So the one before that was Let Go. I'm on a opening out into everything kick. The one before that was Accept Them As They Are. Easier said than done. And the one before that was Accept It Just Altogether. So you can see what they are. They're very short, one thing, just one thing to think about. And so unless you say just slides, I'll subscribe you to that. It's okay to say just slides. There's no bad karma in just slides. And if you already get the newsletter, you won't receive two copies because we'll only send one thing to one email address. Okay, that's all the logistics so far. I do hope to do some experiential things with you, right? It's a really experiential group, so let's get to it. Now, without getting whiplash, can you see the slides up there on the TV screen? Okay, so they've told me this is okay, and I won't mind if you look at the screen and I look at the back of your head. You know, it's really okay. So, okay, great. So let's get to it. This is what I hope to, turn this on. This is what I hope to talk about, if you take a look. Using the mind to change the brain, what's called sometimes self-directed neuroplasticity. Then I want to talk about my theme here, which is embodied happiness, the practical neuroscience of positive emotions. In other words, why is it good to feel good? As you can see in the culture, there are these sort of ebbs and flows of interest in things like happiness or positive psychology. After a wave or so for 5 or 10 years that emphasized happiness, now we're having a counter wave, which is about the power of grumpiness, okay? And why happy people are stupid people. And so I think the truth is probably somewhere in the middle, so I'm going to explore it there. And then I'm going to go into the negativity bias of the brain, the ways in which our brain has evolved to be like Velcro for the bad, but Teflon for the good. The brain is very good at learning from bad experiences, but bad at learning from good experiences, which has profound implications for anybody who's in the learning business. Therapist, parent, I use the word business very broadly here, school teacher, Feldenkrais practitioner, Annette Ben-Yale method person, fill in the blanks altogether, you know. This is a fundamental problem. Because if we don't pay attention to the ways in which the brain actually learns, actually changes structure, we might be helping people to have useful states of mind, useful experiences with their body, useful emotional moments in their relationship. And it's nice in the moment, but it has no lasting value. It's wasted on the brain unless we help it sink in. So that's what the bulk of this presentation is about, the practical neuroscience of helping good things land and stick to our mental ribs. So then we carry them with us wherever we go, okay? I'm going to get into the how of doing that, and I'm going to apply those general methods to some clinical situations. I'll talk about also applying it with children. How many of you have children or work with children? Okay, wow, great, I love it. I'm a longtime child therapist. We have 2 young adult kids, and I remember my childhood very well. All right, okay. And then at the very end, I'm going to talk about, as it says up there, taking the fruit as the path. It's a really quite extraordinary fact that because of experience-dependent neuroplasticity, the way that our experiences can change our brains for the better, that by deliberately cultivating experiences or mental states that are in many ways the fruits of a good life, by actually having those experiences again and again and helping them sink in, we can take the fruits as a profound method that deepens those qualities inside us. And I'll talk about how that can help us come pretty far along the path to the end of the resisting, the grasping, and the clinging, the craving, broadly defined, that can lead to suffering and harm. Okay. So by the way, how's the sound? Is the volume okay? The logistics are good? Feel really free to move around, change your sight line, you know, it's all okay. I don't think there's time to take a break formally, but if you want to get up, use the bathroom, it's really cool, get some more food, come back, what have you. Okay, great. All right, ready to go? Here we go. So, using the mind to change the brain. There's a quote here from Hippocrates going way back in the day. He says, people ought to know that from nothing else but the brain come joys, delights, laughter, and sports, and sorrows, griefs, despondency, and lamentations. Those old Greeks, you know, they really had a way with words. So the idea here is the brain. So here's a brain. There's a picture of a brain. It's a real brain, no longer alive. It's about 3 pounds worth of tofu-like tissue, roughly 5 cups or about 1,300 cubic centimeters in volume. And yet it's considered to be this pretty, you know, unimpressive object. Looks to me kind of like a slowly rotting cauliflower. You know, that's how I visualize the brain. It's considered by scientists to be literally the most complex physical object known in the universe. It has about 1.1 trillion cells in it. 10% or so, 100 billion or so, are neurons. A typical neuron makes about 5,000 connections with other neurons, giving us a network with roughly 500 trillion little nodes in it, little synapses, right? And those synapses are busy. Neurons typically fire 5 to 50 times a second, sometimes more slowly, sometimes more rapidly. And even though a fair amount of that firing is noise, right, still, there are a lot of signals moving through that neural net. During the duration of a single breath, probably about a quadrillion bits of information moved around inside your head. Wow. Most of which are happening completely outside of awareness. All right? So why should we know about the brain? What's the use of knowing about the brain? Mental activity entails underlying neural activity. Mental activity in a neuroscientific frame, a naturalist frame, not a supernatural frame or a transcendental frame. And I personally think there is stuff out there that's, you know, wilder than is dreamt of in all our philosophies, right? As Hamlet said to Horatio. Nonetheless, I'm going to stay inside the natural frame. Inside the natural frame, the nervous system is considered to be an information processing organ. That's its function. So we have a material substrate that moves immaterial, intangible, not physical, information around. That's the hardest thing to understand in my whole presentation. If we get past this one, we're really good to go. And you know what's even better? You don't have to understand it. I don't even fully understand it. Nobody really does. It's the idea that, you know, if you go through a traffic light, right, red, yellow, green, the red, yellow, green is material, especially in the sense that E equals mc squared, right? Energy and matter are part of materiality, all right? The green, yellow, red, or red, yellow, green, rather, top down, is material. But the meaning of red, it's not physical, is it? You can't weigh it. You can't touch it. You can't poke it, right? You can't eat it. You can't breathe it. It's not physical. It exists. Information exists in some sense. But it's different from matter. A computer, hard drive, it's material. It's physical. But it represents non-physical signals, instructions, and so forth. Okay? Most of the information moving through the nervous system is unconscious. A tiny fraction of it is what we see, what we hear, what we feel, what we hope, what we suffer, what we dream, what we love. Right? That's a tiny fraction. It's still a profound mystery. It's the so-called hard problem in neuropsychology. How does the meat make the mind, including the, what is called the so-called qualia of the color red? In other words, how does this physical system produce a conscious experience? That's still a great mystery. But the correlations between mental activity, including the flows of our own experience, the correlations between mental activity and underlying neural activity are incredibly well established in both human and animal research. Okay? So mental activity, in the way that I'm using the word, in the natural frame, okay, mental activity requires, it entails underlying neural activity. That's kind of step one. And I'll give you a couple of images of that. The first is consciousness itself. For us to be aware, to wake up from sleep, or to come to after anesthesia, or come to after a head injury, right? Different parts of the brain, different underlying neural processes have to occur for us to be awake or conscious at all. Or for a squirrel or our pet cat or a lizard or the goldfish in our pond in the backyard, you know, when I come over, they know the ritual. It's as if I am a demigod to them. I feed them. They love me. Actually, I have no idea if they really love me, but they're aware of me, right? Because they come when I approach the pond, right? That awareness is supported by some kind of underlying physical substrate, right? Here's another example up there. These are college sophomores, of course, the great guinea pigs of modern psychology. And this is a composite of an MRI shot that's a slice of the brain like this. And these are college students who are head over heels in love, young men and young women, who've just been shown a picture of their sweetheart. And that red little blob right there, good, my little pointer does work, that orangey blob just marks the caudate nucleus, a part of the brain that's involved in experiences of reward. It also lights up when people take cocaine, or win the lottery, or have a profound spiritual experience of union with the divine. All right? I'm not equating all those, but they're rewarding. And it just illustrates that, as one more example, certain kinds of mental activity require underlying neural activity. Here's an image that's a little probably closer to home. How many of you meditate or pray 1 minute or more a month? 1 minute a month. Just as a really low bar. Even my wife kind of has her finger up. Okay, good. She's a deep practitioner. Yeah. And anyway, my point is, so no more personal questions. So we've all kind of had the experience of meditating. This is the picture of a brain sliced this way, okay, like that. And the orange blob that activates is in the cingulate cortex, a part of the brain that's involved in mindfulness, or the top-down control of attention, executive functions, right? And this particular person is trying to send boundless compassion to all beings inside an MRI that's claustrophobic, loud, and weird, okay? He's got to really concentrate. So he lights up. Mental activity, concentration, requires underlying neural activity. Just another illustration of this fundamental point. All right. Now let's start moving into the money part of this whole business. Like, why should we care? Right? Next slide. Repeated mental activity entails repeated neural activity. Repeated neural activity builds neural structure. Okay? In other words, in the famous saying in neuroscience, neurons that fire together wire together. Okay? I swear I'm going to do like a rap song about that someday, but people pay me not to sing, so it's all good. No worries. In other words, we're talking about learning and memory. How do we learn? What my talk tonight is about is how to turbocharge emotional learning, you know, sensory learning, attitudinal learning, motivational learning, you know, how to help ourselves choose the high road rather than the low road as a kind of learning, the learning of confidence, the learning of the experience of feeling loved, the learning of becoming even more compassionate toward others, more patient even toward them. All right, that's the kind of learning we're talking about here, how to do it well. It really helps to appreciate that there are two kinds of learning. There are two, which means in science, in psychology and neuroscience, learning means changing brain structure. Okay? It's been understood for well over a century, if not longer, going all the way back to Hippocrates, that if there's any kind of learning, something had to change in the brain, inside the natural frame. Otherwise, how did we learn? The breaking news of the last decade or two is the mechanisms of that process and how to use them in increasingly skillful ways. Okay? So if you think about learning, there's explicit learning, it's called that, where we recall specific events or we learn about. That's declarative knowledge. The other kind of learning is actually much more important. It's implicit memory. Not explicit memory, but implicit memory. knowledge how to, not about, but how to. Knowledge of procedures, what's called procedural knowledge. Emotional attitudes. How many of you are psychotherapists, by any chance? Okay, fraction. So it's object relations or relationship paradigms, models of relationship. That also goes into implicit memory. Assumptions, expectations, and the inner atmosphere, the mood inside the mind. That's in implicit memory. So it becomes very important to think about, okay, how can we change implicit memory, motor memory? You know, including very subtle patterns of posture or gesture or stance. That's all in the territory of implicit memory. Right? If you think about it, we're in the implicit memory profession. I'm a longtime therapist, teacher, writer, and that's my job. I'm in the business of changing brain structure in terms of implicit memory, and I think most of you are as well. All right? So by the way, I'll get through a few more things, and then I'll just kind of open it up for discussion, and then we'll start sliding into something pretty experiential. Okay? So as an image of this, this is a slide that's taken from a study on meditators done out of Harvard by Sarah Lazar and colleagues. And they compared longtime meditators to non-meditators who were matched in terms of age and education, socioeconomic status, and so forth. All right? And what they found is that the brains, the cortex, the outer layer of the brain, which comes from the root word bark, the outer layer of the brain, the cortex of longtime meditators, far from perfect meditators, right? Meditators kind of like us. 40 minutes today, 5 minutes tomorrow, guilty conscience, 20 minutes the day after, you know, skip a day, really guilty conscience, 45 minutes the day after that, and so forth. Okay. So still, their brains were measurably thicker compared to those of non-meditators in three key regions. One, up there, the insula, which is a part of the brain on the inside of the temporal lobes that we use to tune into ourselves. That makes sense. If you lift a muscle, if you work a muscle repeatedly, it'll get bigger, right? So what do we do when we meditate? We tune into ourselves. Interestingly, the insula is also involved in empathy for the feelings of others. So by tuning into our own bodies repeatedly, and these are mindfulness meditators typically doing mindfulness of the breath, mindfulness of the interior, if we tune into ourselves repeatedly, and studies back this up as well, we naturally become more empathic for the emotions of other people. All right? So that's one area where literally, in some sense, the meditators had bigger brains in the sense that I'm using here, thicker cortex. The second region were areas in the front of the brain, the executive systems in the front, because what you do when you meditate is you regulate your attention and you regulate your impulses. And studies do show that as people practice some kind of contemplative practice, whatever it is, prayer, meditation, whatever their chosen form of meditation is, they actually develop more executive functions. They become better at regulating themselves, including managing their emotions and their impulses. The third region up there was at the very tip top, somatosensory cortex. They were tuning into their bodies. They got a little benefit there. The other thing to see, if you don't mind twisting your head, is the scatter plot on the right on the bottom. And here's the bottom line takeaway of that. Normally, we lose about 10,000 brain cells a day. That's a lot. But if you start with 1.1 trillion, and you also grow 2 to 3, you know, about 700 a day in what's called neurogenesis, the net of it is we've usually lost several percent by our 80th birthday. That is what's called normal cortical thinning, which is associated with normal cognitive decline due to aging. Not dementia, not Alzheimer's, but walking into a room and going, why did I walk into the room? You got to go back to the original room. Oh yeah, that's what it was. It was this thing, okay, in this room. I don't know anybody else besides me, but okay, word finding, whatever. All right, check it out. So you could see that the blue circle people were the meditators. And you could see that the red square people were the controls. The older people that were the non-meditators indeed experienced normal cortical thinning due to aging. Their brains got thinner because they were losing brain cells. They were losing structure, okay? But the blue circle people, the older people did not experience cortical thinning due to aging. They used it, so they did not lose it. And that has a lot of implications, obviously, for an aging population and people in general. All right. What's the point? We can use the mind to change the brain, to change the mind for the better, to benefit ourselves and all beings. In other words, we can use the power of self-directed neuroplasticity to target certain underlying neural substrates of happiness, confidence, more appropriate, you know, motor planning, more functional integration in a person. We can target the neural substrates that support these useful, wholesome states of mind. And through targeted mental activity, we can stimulate them. And because when you stimulate them, you strengthen them, right? We can actually grow capacity inside ourselves in terms of what we really care about, right? Tell a little story here, Two Wolves in the Heart. You may know this story. I heard it in this form. I've heard it in a slightly different form later on. A woman, a grandmother, a Native American woman, was asked toward the end of her life, what did you do, grandmother, to become so happy? You're like the happiest person in the tribe. You're also the wisest. Everybody listens to you. They want to know what you think. How did you do it, right? And she pauses and reflects for a moment, and she says, you know, I think it's because I realized when I was young that there are two wolves in my heart, one of love and one of hate. And I realized that everything depended on which one I fed each day. The brain is constantly changing its structure. It's the organ that learns. It's continually changing its structure based on what's flowing through our consciousness and how we relate to what's flowing through our consciousness. The only question is it changing for better or worse? And also, who's doing the changing? The forces outside us, the people we live with, media, the pace of technology, the pace of modern life, the, you know, as Selma Freiberg put it a long time ago, the ghosts in the nursery, the legacy inside us of our own upbringing that affects us still to this day? Or are we going to be deliberately using the power of experience-dependent neuroplasticity to change our own brains for the better? That's really the question here. There's no question about whether it's changing. The only question is, which wolf will we feed? Which direction will the changes go? Okay? So any questions or comments so far? And then I want to get into more and more how to actually do this. It's okay so far? Basic idea? Okay? All right. Well, let's keep going. All right? Now I want to talk about the good news. Then I'll do the bad news. Why is it good to take in the good? Or why is it good to feel good? All right? It's interesting that if Merck or Pfizer could patent the proven in hardcore research benefits of positive emotions, we'd be seeing ads for happiness all day long in primetime TV, right? Because positive emotions, for one, emotions organize the brain as a whole. They're very interesting. Emotions, as you know, are a more or less recent evolutionary breakthrough. Reptiles are capable of very, very rudimentary emotions, especially more advanced reptiles. They have the hardware that can do basic fear and basic rage and basic lust. But it's pretty basic, trust me. You know, if you have like a snake or my goldfish, right? They're not very friendly, really. I'm just a food source and all that. Mammals, a couple hundred million years ago, started evolving emotions. And among other things that emotions do is they organize us as a whole. That means that our negative emotions organize the brain as a whole in problematic ways, whereas positive emotions organize the brain as a whole in good ways. And you can see the list up there. I'll just kind of go through some of the highlights. Let's see, they promote what's called approach orientation, going out and exploring rather than hunkering down and feeling scared. We can try new things. We can have an opportunity focus. We can be willing to learn new things if we're experiencing positive emotion. Positive emotion is motivating. It's also emotions over time gradually lift mood and increase resilience. It's interesting that feeling happy makes us tougher, happy broadly defined. You know, feeling grateful, feeling loving, feelings of awe, feelings of pleasure, just feelings of ordinary contentment or joy, that actually makes us more able over time to deal with the hard things in life. Also, positive emotions affect physical health. They strengthen the immune system, and they protect the cardiovascular system against stress. It's interesting, one study that was done by Barbara Fredrickson and her colleagues, took people that they had data on before 9/11, the Twin Towers fell. These were people living in the East Coast, especially in New York, right, who were then very stressed by what happened there, obviously. And then they compared the impact of that event on 9/11 and everything that followed after on people, and found that people who had higher kind of resting state, positive emotions, you know, they were just generally happier people. They were less stressed by all of that. They recovered more rapidly, and they had fewer cardiovascular problems. Right? In other words, positive emotions had a protective function for them in terms of very hardcore physical effects on their health. The last thing I'll just say about it is that positive emotions, among other benefits, create positive cycles, right? When we feel kind of good, we don't have to feel great. You know what I mean? On the 0 to 10 intensity scale, it's ones and twos. We're feeling good. If we feel good, we act good. We act well, typically. We're kind of nicer to other people. We try new things. Not always, but often that work goes well. And then that gives us more reason to feel good in a nice positive cycle. So then we act good in the next moment. That's the nice thing about positive emotions. Now, more broadly, positive emotions build, in the next slide, inner strengths. Inner strengths of all kinds. Positive emotions are a type of inner strength, and positive emotions build inner strengths. Think about the classic lists of inner strengths, like the virtues, or attitudes, or hardiness, resilience, being tough, capabilities of various kinds. These are inner strengths, broadly defined. And my question is, how to get them into the brain? And in other words, I think, I don't know about you, I've done a lot of stuff in wilderness, a lot of rock climbing, a certain amount of things in the mountains. And you want to think about what's in your backpack. It gets really concrete. Do I have water? Check. I've climbed with a guy, my longtime climbing partner, Bob, really, really smart guy, professor at Harvard, blah, blah. He never remembers to bring a jacket. I'm like, they call it the male mother. I'm like a male mother, you know. I bring along a jacket because he's an idiot, you know. He's a physician, so I figure like if I break my head open, he'll fix me on the spot, thank God. The other person I climbed with routinely was a psychiatrist, so I thought I had, you know, both bases covered, right? All my knees were going to be, I should have brought a minister along, but then I really would have had the whole package, I guess. But anyway, but Bob just doesn't remember to bring a jacket. You know, we need to have the good stuff in our backpack, okay? What do you want in your own backpack? What are you helping people to grow in their backpack in terms of inner strengths for the long and sometimes hard, often hard, you know, road of life, okay? So that then takes us to what are the causes of inner strengths? How do we grow the good stuff inside us? How do we grow happiness inside? How do you grow feeling loved inside? Especially if you've had some setbacks in that department. How do you grow the feeling of worth? How do you help a child grow the confidence to sleep alone in their bedroom, or to feel that even though those other kids at school are jerks, I'm still a good person. How do we help that grow? How do we help someone actually learn a useful motor act? I mean, that's one of the things for me that's so genius, honestly, about Feldenkrais and Anand, that there is this intelligence about how to help people learn in their motor system, their sensory motor systems, which is, of course, the foundation of cognition altogether. If you want to help people think more clearly, help their bodies move more effectively and harmoniously, right? So how do we get this stuff going? Well, the causes of inner strengths inside the brain are experiences of them. In other words, the brain is not like an iPod. You know, my smartphone, right, which I'm using to keep time here. If I want to get more songs into my smartphone, I just connect it to my computer and I drag the icons over or something like that. You know, think about the movie The Matrix, right? I don't know if you ever saw it. I'm a total sci-fi geek, but anyway. You know, they stick a cable in the back of his head and suddenly, he knows how to do kung fu, or now he knows how to fly a, you know, helicopter, okay? The brain is not like that. The brain is like an old school cassette. Darn, I saw that finger snap. Darn, I agree. But at least as far as we know so far, okay? Current technology. Under normal conditions, the brain is like a cassette recorder. It's like an old school, or currently a DVR or VCR. You record the song by playing it. You gotta play the song. You have to have the experience of the inner strength to record it in the brain, That's a fundamental point, right? How do we get the inner strengths in us? We need to have experiences of them or their related factors. For example, if you want to, for example, feel more compassionate to others, have repeated experiences of compassion. If you want to feel more determined or stronger or more assertive, got a boss who's kind of pushy, a partner who's kind of pushy, a teenager who's kind of pushy, fill in the blank, right? If you want to feel more assertive, have multiple experiences of determination, of will, of a muscularity, of getting through tough times, right? If you want to feel more, you know, loved or worthy inside, have more experiences of feeling included or seen or appreciated or liked or even loved, right? We get these inner strengths, broadly defined, the learning that we really want, we get it by growing it, and we grow it by having experiences of it. But there is a problem. Okay. Yeah. Which I'll get to in a second. Yeah, you want to make a comment there? Thanks. Or a question or something?
Well, I didn't know you had a microphone handy.
Yeah.
It makes me think of, then, how do you delete a song?
Right,
you know?
Right,
I mean, do you record over it, or do you actually delete the memory? You know?
Yeah, well, so just to repeat it as also, how do you delete the bad songs, you know? Right? In a sense, it's like a jukebox. The brain's like a jukebox. You know, I'm dating myself, obviously, but I think we all know what a jukebox is. And the question is, what are the bad songs, as it were? And I'm using the word bad and good and negative and positive, not moralistically, but pragmatically. For me, good is that which leads to happiness and welfare for ourselves and often others, and bad or negative is what leads to suffering and harm for ourselves and often for others. Okay? Most pragmatically positive experiences feel pleasant, which is really interesting, you know? On the other hand, there are some pragmatically positive experiences that feel unpleasant, like healthy remorse, right? Or the disenchantment when you realize you're in a relationship with someone and it's just not going to get you what you need, right? It's like trying to get water from a stone, or it's trying to go down a tunnel with no cheese, or it's like being with a dog who won't hunt, or it's like sending a duck to eagle school. All right, that's all I've got. But anyway, you know what I mean? Like, that's sorrowful. It's disenchantment. Yuck. But it's an important experience to have. And there's some pragmatically negative experiences that feel pleasant, right? There is that kind of release and just dumping anger out on the space. But on the whole, most pragmatically positive experiences actually feel pleasant. So then the question becomes, how to pull the plug on the negative ones? And I'm actually going to talk about that real soon. And actually how to do that, because that's a real interest, of course. And do it in a way that's respectful to oneself and also to others. So I'm going to duck the question for a moment, but I'm going to get to it really soon. Okay? Okay, great. Any other questions, comments so far? One more, and then I'm going to get into the problem. Yeah.
It's not a problem. It's just kind of seeing that as a pretty much evolution in a sense where we're seeing that in the environment. You know, if you have everybody think in a specific way, let's say political, war, peace, you know, if the majority's war, where evolution, it takes time in order to transcend into the peace era, it's going to take, you know, masses and masses of changes of the song in order to create that peace in maybe 10, 20 years, hopefully, right?
Well,
so it's kind of training within your environment, because if one does it in 1 million are opposing it, how are you going to change the song type thing, right?
You're totally right. And the way I would kind of sort of build on what you said is to talk about sort of a framework that for me, if we want to make things better, there are basically three domains of intervention. We can intervene out there in the world in terms of things like war or the economy, the healthcare system, or just bringing fresh water to people, or teaching them about sanitation, or washing their hands, you know, after whatever. We can also intervene in our bodies directly through medicine, through good diet, through direct intervention in the body of, you know, like body work or what have you. And we can intervene in the mind. Now, some things are combos. You know, I think of, you know, Ben-Yale method as a combination of intervening in the body and also intervening in the mind. There are a lot of things that go together. My focus here is intervening in the mind. But I want to acknowledge that there are a lot of things we can do out there in the world to make the world a better place. It's not either or. And in fact, as we make the world a better place, it's easier to intervene in the mind. And as we intervene in the mind, we have more resources inside us, more inner strengths that we can tap, we can draw upon to help make the world a better place. Okay? So here's the problem, though, all right? There's a bottleneck in the brain. In other words, as I said earlier, even though the primary source of the inner strengths, my umbrella term for happiness, for confidence, for good motor learning, for executive functions, for feeling loved, for feeling loving, even though the primary source of those inner strengths are positive experiences of them, the brain is bad at turning those positive experiences into neural structure. To use a certain kind of technical language, the brain is bad at turning positive mental states that are fleeting and momentary, positive mental states into lasting positive neural traits. But meanwhile, as you'll see momentarily, the brain is really good at turning negative experiences into lasting neural structure, turning negative mental states into lasting negative neural traits. All right. Why is this? This is the negativity bias of the brain. Okay? This is the brain being like Velcro for the bad, but Teflon for the good. So, okay, I'm going to do this in a second. So the negativity bias. As our ancestors evolved, they needed to go get those carrots, you know, like food, mating opportunities, all the rest, shelter. And they also needed to avoid sticks, quote unquote, like predators or natural hazards or aggression in their primate band or between bands, primates, hominids, early humans, modern humans. Okay? What's the difference between carrots and sticks? If you fail to get that carrot today, you'll have a chance at one tomorrow. If you fail to avoid that stick today, no more carrots forever. Sticks are more consequential in terms of raw survival, usually more consequential in terms of raw survival and passing on genes, which is the fundamental engine of biological evolution. Okay, what are called reproductive advantages. I've thought about using that phrase with my wife, but I've known that it would not go well. Okay, anyway, so my point is, she's corroborating that. Anyway, so from that standpoint, sticks have more urgency and impact. You know, and there are many, 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 many examples of the negativity bias. For example, you're in a relationship with someone, 10 things happen, 4 are pleasant, 4 are neutral, 2 are negative. Which are the ones you're going to think about? Yeah. Studies on relationships show that a good long-term relationship needs at least a 5-to-1 ratio of positive to negative interactions. That's a cautionary tale from the perspective of the other person. Oh, you know, think about that. So, in other words, in effect, 1 negative interaction is as powerful as 5 positive ones. Or the research on learned helplessness. It's painfully, poignantly, tragically easy to train people in a sense of futility, entrapment, and defeat. And they usually need many times as many counterexamples, twice as many, 5 times as many, 10 times as many counterexamples to start restoring a sense of agency or efficacy, or basically being a hammer instead of a nail. Right? That's another example of the negativity bias. Negative information about somebody is more memorable than positive information, which is a major reason why so much political advertising is negative, because it's much more memorable and consequential. Okay? Or as you can see in the image here, as I've said, the brain is like Velcro for the bad and Teflon for the good. That has a lot of consequences. When most of our ancestors died young, right, in hunter-gatherer bands, including modern hunter-gatherer bands, you know, 5 out of 6 children, 5 out of 6 babies are no longer alive by their 6th birthday. Only 1 in 6, on average, lives to his or her 6th birthday. Okay, you know, under tough conditions, where being 40 was ancient, I think about all the little things that have happened for me along the way that could have taken me out well before now. You know, a double hernia when I was 16. I'm quite nearsighted. I wear contact lenses. Just an abscess, a bad toothache will kill people. You know, blood poisoning going in, you know, and into the brain fairly rapidly. In that context, it made sense in terms of passing on genes to pay a price, to make an exchange, a trade-off, to have short-term benefits from the negativity bias with long-term costs that didn't matter because people were usually dead by their 30th or certainly their 40th birthday. But these days, when we're interested in living long, living healthy lives. My dad's 94, almost 95. He's got his mind fully intact. He's healthy and spry. He's got a full head of hair. He's really a catch. I'm not going to tell you where he lives. All right. Anyway, he no longer has a girlfriend, you know. She couldn't keep up with him. So she was just 80, and she just couldn't hang with a 94-year-old. So anyway, we want to live well, right? Okay, how do we want to live? Plus, we want to not get caught up in negativity because it's very, 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 very consequential for us. I think what I'm going to do, because you already know this stuff about the health consequences, mental and physical, of chronic stress, I'm going to bounce ahead so we can kind of get into some practices. Here's the bottom line image. There we go. Happy about this image because our daughter made it. All right? We've got Stone Age brains living in the 21st century. And hey, there's a lot about the 21st century that's great for the Stone Age brains. Refrigeration, pain control, flush toilets, ESPN, right? What's not to like? On the other hand, you know, Mother Nature's plan is for our animals like us to mostly be chill. Like, imagine, visualize zebras. Zebras in Africa, herd of zebras. They're just kind of hanging out. They're looking over their shoulder, but they're just sort of hanging out. They're chill. They're in the green zone, as it were. And then suddenly, kaboom, a pride of lions attacks, right? And those zebras have a burst of red zone stress, a spike, if you will. Red zone stress, and that, as Robert Sapolsky talks about it in his great book, Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers, most episodes of red zone stress in the wild end quickly, one way or another. Right? And so then they're back to just kind of grazing, chilling out, back in the green zone. Okay, most of us today don't have to run in screaming terror from a charging lion. Right? We don't have, it's tragically, some people are exposed to that level of stress. It's really poignant. But most people live in a realm of mild to moderate stress. The problem is we live in chronic mild to moderate stress with very little recovery between these little bursts of stress, juggling emails, multitasking, running around, raising children when the village it takes to raise a child actually looks more like a ghost town in so many places these days, right? Hassling with other people. The same machinery, the same neural and hormonal machinery that evolved to get us away from those charging lions is locked and loaded today when we're stuck in traffic late for a meeting, right? Or we're dealing with someone who's given us that look across a dinner table. Ready for the teenage look? You know, the same system activates. Ba-boom, we're back in the red zone, you know? So it's the modern life is basically the way so many of us live in chronic, mild to moderate red zone stress is absolutely against the blueprint that Mother Nature has endowed us with, and it has lots of consequences. What can we do about it, right? We can use the mind to change the brain, to change the mind for the better. We can install shock absorbers inside us so we're less rattled by events. Life is challenging, but we don't need to be so reactive to it. Things can happen, but by building up inner strengths over time, it's in a sense like deepening the keel of a sailboat. You know, having sailed a boat in this class I took that had no keel, and I capsized the boat. And one of the lessons there is fasten your life jacket before you're swimming or dumped in the Pacific Ocean. But anyway, all right, so a sailboat with no keel, is you got to be really careful when you sail it. And it's kind of hard to sail when things are intense. But if you have a deep keel in your boat, whoosh, 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 you can go out in the deep waters of life and have some fun out there. And also create good things with other people. And even if you get banged hard, you're going to recover a lot more quickly if you've internalized again and again and again by using your mind to change your brain, to change your mind for the better. You've internalized again and again the neural substrates of inner strengths. So now, how to do that. And that's what my bit here is about. Okay, any questions or comments so far? And I'm so happy about time. We have plenty of time. Okay, yeah, all the way in the back. Please, you're willing to talk into the mic just for people seeing the recording. Thanks a lot for putting up with this. It's like an ice cream cone.
Just a quick question. I'm always curious about optimism versus pessimism. Is it genetic? Is it learned experience? Where does that fit into changing our brain?
Yeah. Okay. So, first of all, you're right. People do vary temperamentally in whether they tend to be optimistic or pessimistic. and also whether they tend to react more intensely to pleasant experiences or to unpleasant ones. We want to be able to do both, but people as a kind of disposition tend to lean one way or the other. And then life happens. And I didn't show you the series of slides there, but as one more example of the negativity bias, we have a brain that has evolved several mechanisms that, pardon me, make it very vulnerable to becoming increasingly sensitized to the negative. In other words, if it starts out like as the default, like Velcro for the negative, but basically Teflon for the positive, if people have repeated stressful experiences, which release cortisol, that over time makes their brain like super Velcro for the negative and Teflon for the positive. That's because cortisol, stress hormone, sensitizes the alarm bell of the brain, the amygdala, and cortisol overstimulates and gradually kills neurons in the hippocampus, another part of the brain next to the amygdala that puts things in context, and the hippocampus calms down the alarm bell. And the hippocampus tells the hypothalamus, another part of the brain, to quit calling for stress hormones. You see the effect. Stress today makes our alarm bell more sensitive and louder, and stress today makes the brakes on our alarm bell and the brakes on other sources of stress hormones weaker, which makes us more reactive and stress responsive the day after, which makes us really vulnerable to stress the day after that in a vicious cycle. And as another illustration of the negativity bias, there's no comparable mechanism that can gradually sensitize the brain to positive experiences. It does look like, as we'll get into shortly, that if people routinely take in the good, if they repeatedly really register and install in themselves positive experiences, you know, emotionally positive experiences, that you can make your brain stickier and stickier for the positive. But it's a fairly subtle process. It's hopeful, it's progressive, but it's nowhere as powerful as the way in which the brain is very vulnerable to being changed by negative experiences. One of my own takeaways from going into this material for the last 10 years or so, pretty deeply, is I'm a lot more careful about what I just indulge in my mind. I'm going to talk about momentarily appropriate ways of handling negative experiences, where we don't go negative on negative, because then you just have more negative. But on the other hand, think about the amount of time we just indulge negative experiences. We ruminate about stuff unproductively. As Sokni Rinpoche, a Tibetan Buddhist teacher, says, think the same thought over and over, no worries. But 10 is enough, right? In other words, we just keep going. Or we work that grumbling case about other people. Oh, they did me wrong. Oh, I'm so resentful. They're so stupid. That's negative. We're just kind of marinating in the negative, right? Or we beat ourselves up. I'm a lot more careful now about what is muttering away in the back of my mind, because neurons that fire together wire together. And my brain, like everybody's brain, is particularly spongy. It's particularly absorbent for negative experiences. Right? So what to do about that? Yeah, and then I want to slide into the how-to. So I'll take two more questions right here, if it's okay, and then we can get into the how-to. So thanks for sliding by and running the mic. Okay, great. Yeah, please.
Yes, I have two questions. First is in the research that you show what kind of meditation that you are focusing on. And the second is a lot of people would like to do the meditation, but they might have a lot of anxiety or overwhelming, or you know. Yeah. So is it a period of they just listen to some kind of music and make them calm? Mm-hmm. Really count on that, the stage of meditation that can help change in something in the brain?
Okay, good. Thank you. So first point is that meditation, which I'm a fan of, I think meditation is to the brain and the mind what aerobic exercise is to physical health. It's a broad, general purpose, highly beneficial practice for most people. There are some people who, when they meditate for various reasons, it's actually not that good for them. They tend to be more vulnerable, but for most people, they can do it. And meditation is just one of the many ways to change the brain. Those of you that are already trained by Anat or in this process of being trained by her are changing the brains of people. Or if you go through the process yourself, your own brain is changing. Any kind of learning has to be brain change. All right. That said, arguably probably the single mental activity that has had the most research on it in terms of changing the brain is meditation. that's the case for multiple reasons, including the fact that a lot of early scientists wanted to debunk it, while others who are more involved in transcendental meditation wanted to support it being good. Okay, so I just want to put meditation in context. That said, there is research that shows that different kinds of meditation, just like different kinds of mental activity, have overlapping but somewhat distinct effects. And for example, people who do meditations that are very involved in loving kindness or warm-heartedness or compassion, they tend to build up more of the neural circuits that are emotional and inclined to help. People who, on the other hand, focus more on really concentrating, let's say on the sensations of breathing at the upper lip or a single mantra, they develop more of the executive functions or networks in the brain that are involved in top-down control. It's all good, and often in a person's life, they mix the meditations together, or they do one for a while and they kind of shift increasingly to the other. All right? And there are other examples of this kind of thing in terms of the specifics about it. For many people, I think that if you think about natural temperament, we evolved neurological diversity, temperamental diversity. Think about, you know, anxious, rigid turtles at one end and spirited ADHD-type jackrabbits at the other with a lot of tweeners in between. You know, bands that had a diversity of temperament could outcompete bands that were just turtles, just jackrabbits, or just tweeners, right? Isn't that kind of cool? And that's for me, I don't think of ADHD, by the way, as a disorder. I think it's a fantastic adaptation to have somebody in your tribe or a few people in your tribe who are kind of always scanning and quickly bored and high energy and what up, you know? As well as you want to have people that are like, in modern society, future accountants, very careful, cautious. We need the tribe needs all types. So if you think about that for meditation, most contemplative practices, most meditative practices have been developed by people who are temperamentally turtles to train people in becoming even better turtles in turtle pen monasteries, right? But what do you do in modern life when we got a lot of jackrabbits we want to include, plus we have a very jackrabbity culture? So I think it's important to be willing to adapt your methods, to meditate for shorter periods or meditate in ways that are more stimulating, like by walking or by focusing on loving kindness. That's going to be more stimulating. Or the breath in the whole body, not just in one place, or meditating on the feeling of pleasure in the body, or bliss, or joy. These are perfectly appropriate things to do. Or, as you said, use resources like music or other sorts of things to kind of draw you into the zone. Maybe do a little yoga before you meditate, or meditate while you do yoga. My bottom line is, what works? You know, my own background, I'm pretty aware of many of the world's contemplative traditions, but the one I'm most aware of is Buddhism. I'm most trained in that, especially the early teachings of the Buddha himself. And it's interesting that he offered literally many dozens of meditative practices. If there was just one for everybody, he would have stuck with that. But no, many people need different things at different times. And I'm a fan, bottom line, of what works. You know the most important exercise to do? It's the one you'll actually do. You want to know the most important, the best meditative practice? It's the one you'll actually do, right? You know what I mean? And stick with. Okay, that's my thing. All right, next person, and then I'll move on to how to actually do this, how to get the good stuff to sink in.
Yes, I'm wondering how you might change a brain's negative mm-hmm. belief when it's attached to a strong belief system, like somebody who's afraid of going to hell or something of that nature, where you have to get into the actual belief? I don't know.
Right. That's a great question. Let me do that question or respond to it in the context of a kind of a framework I'm going to use here. And it'll give us a way to walk through it. All right? So if you could, I'm going to move along here. The point being that just because of the brain's negativity bias and the fact that it's not that good at turning positive mental states into lasting neural traits, it means that just having positive experiences is not enough. This is an incredibly important point. It's humbling for me as a longtime therapist, parent, teacher, whatever. Just having a useful experience is not enough unless we help it sink into the brain. And this is the fundamental weakness in psychotherapy, all kinds of body trainings, mindfulness trainings, meditation trainings, addiction recovery experiences, corporate you know, stress management trainings, character education for children, whatever, we have assumed we're very good in the mental health fields, broadly defined, at activating useful mental states. But there's just been this kind of assumption, like throwing mud on the wall, that it'll somehow stick, right? But actually, tons and tons of research shows that unless we stay with this positive experience long enough, and long enough varies from person to person, 5, 10, 20 seconds in a row, unless we stay with it long enough, it won't transfer out of short-term memory buffers into long-term storage. It gets dislodged by the next experience, the next neutral or even positive experience. It's nice to have one positive experience after another, right? But when the, you know, parade is over, when the supply dries up, it can start to feel like you're running on empty because we haven't taken it in. We haven't internalized it in ourselves. You know, so bottom line, as I said, mental health, broadly defined, is very good at activating useful mental states and hasn't put very much attention at all on how to install activated useful mental states, how to install them as lasting neural traits. And that's personally been what's really interested me. You know, I don't think it adds, it's good to figure out new ways to activate useful mental states, but there's so many ways already. I don't think the incremental value there is very high. But to help people really learn how to install useful activated mental states, to me, wow, there's a lot of opportunity there. There's a lot of things we can develop in that realm. All right? But to do that, to do cultivation of the good inside us, to me, it's important to put it in context. And that's what this slide is about. I think that there are three ways to engage the mind. There are three ways to practice. One, we can just be with what's there. We let it be. We feel the feelings. We experience the experience. Like in your example now, the negative thought, okay, we observe the negative thought. We try to hold it in a big space of mindfulness. We try to step back from it, disidentify from it, get out of the movie, you know, and then get back 20 rows looking at it going, whoa, that's intense, all right? We let it be. We don't try to influence it in any way. We just observe it. We witness it. Sometimes called choiceless awareness or bare witnessing, okay? That's a profoundly important and powerful way to practice with the mind. But it's not the only way. Another way to practice with the mind is to reduce what's negative, to release tension in the body, to let things go, to try to help exaggerated or catastrophizing or overly generalizing or overly negative thoughts, beliefs, to help them kind of move along, right? To cry, to vent, to let go. That's the second way to engage the mind. And the third way is to grow good things, to cultivate wholesome qualities, to cultivate loving kindness, to cultivate mindfulness, to cultivate determination, moral inclinations, to cultivate our sobriety, right? Or to cultivate our own confidence to speak from the heart and ask for the love that we need, right? That's the third way to engage the mind. If the mind is like a garden, we can witness the garden, we can pull weeds, or we can plant flowers, right? Three basic ways to engage the mind. They're all important. So let's walk through this example kind of quickly here, right? So in the first case, let's suppose someone is realizing that they've got this belief that, fill in the blank, that they won't be loved, or they're kind of dumb, or they're not worth very much, okay? And for me, growing up, as a very, very young kid going through school, because I skipped a grade and I have a very late birthday, I had a lot of experiences where I thought I was a wimp, okay? Some kind of wussy, because I was small, I was afraid of these big alpha male guys, and I didn't get a lot of modeling from my dad on how to deal with that stuff. So that was a thought I had. Then somewhere in my 20s, I started being aware that this was a background belief, that I was a wimp. I had been a wimp. I was a wimp. And I started looking at it. I was like, wow, this is trippy. I started unpacking it, investigating it. I was just being with it. I was just the first way to engage the mind. And then at some point, I realized that it was unfair, that actually I had been a nerd, not a wimp. I was king of the dorks, trust me. My wife has photographs of me in high school and other situations, college, king of the dorks. All right, fine. Fully fine, okay? But I wasn't a wimp. There were so many examples of standing up to people, being determined, being tough, not letting myself get picked on. Whoa, I realized that was a wrong thought. It just wasn't true. It's like a false belief in psycholingo. Okay, now I'm in the second stage. How could I help someone let go of that false belief, right? And so I would deliberately try to let it go. I would catch myself thinking it. I would say, nope, that's not true. I would try to help it go away. And third, I didn't just release what was negative. I tried to replace what was negative with some good alternative. Because as any gardener knows, if you pull the weeds but don't put something good back there, the weeds will come back, right? So I deliberately tried to let it in and look for many examples, and I'll get into how to do it momentarily, of being, yes, fairly dorky, but strong, determined, capable, enduring, lasting, not a wimp. Right? See that process? Now, there's a sequence to it. We have to honor the first part. Because if we jump over the first part, as I did a lot when I was younger, because I didn't want to feel my pain. If we jump over the first part, the second and third ways to engage the mind, letting go and letting in, don't have traction. Right? They're not honest. If you try to move into the releasing phase and it just doesn't seem to work, warning bells, go back to the first step of being with it longer. Now, sometimes to be with our mind, we have to jump to the third way to engage the mind. We have to resource ourselves to bear our pain, to stay with it. As they say in Alcoholics Anonymous, the mind is a dangerous neighborhood. Never go in alone, right? We want to have internal allies, you know, people with us, our kind of inner nurturing committee with us to help us be with our pain. Or we need to be able to relax or do what's called distress tolerance in psychology, where we can tolerate our feelings without getting completely sucked into them and swept away by them. So sometimes we resource ourselves, we grow flowers in the garden of our mind, so then we can go back here and pop open the trapdoor to hell, but not get sucked down into it, all right? So all are important. There's a kind of rhythm often. We start with something painful and difficult. We be with it for a while. It could be a few minutes. Maybe it's just some of the usual suspects. Oh, yeah, that's my stepfather's voice in my head. Thank you for sharing, Frank. Anything new to say? Fine, got it, you know. Or maybe we've had a loss. Maybe something really painful has happened, and long enough is a year or more where we just be with it, right? We feel the pain. We bear it. But at some point, it is time to let it go. It's time to kind of move on, to help it release, and then hopefully replace it with some positive alternative. So that's what I want to talk about now. Okay? All right. So even the monks, as you'll see in the slide right there, in the Buddhist tradition, that are very focused on being with the mind as a very, very important aspect of practice, even they, look up there, that word cultivation, are interested in cultivation. All right? So how do we cultivate? How do we grow flowers in the garden of the mind, given the brain's negativity bias and given the ways in which neural structure is grown? This is where I've come up with this acronym HEAL, H-E-A-L,